The first test I've chosen and prepared is, in my opinion, one of those tests which is often omitted, and it's a very, very important test, and that's the battery itself. The battery no longer can be considered just the storage of electrical energy. It's an integrated part of the electronic control circuit. The purpose of the test is to observe voltage drop against load, measured as current, by the consumer. Now, in every good circuit, all of the load should be consumed by the consumer, in our case, the starter motor. Now, I mentioned the word simplistic approach. Don't complicate the use of a scope. So, what's the function of a starter motor? It's to rotate the engine. It's to create enough rotation speed of the engine to enable efficient prompt starting. Now, a good example of where there is a subsidiary of reasons why the rotation of the engine is important, not just to get good efficient compression, which on diesel is very important, equally so on direct petrol these days, but also you're driving, in our case, the high pressure common rail pump. And unless we achieve a certain amount of pressure, once again, this applies to direct petrol also, then the injectors are not released, the vehicle will not start. So rotation speed of the engine is vital. So the correct specification of the battery, the health status, and the consumer are all being tested with this process. That is the focus of this test. I've chosen, now, let me just perhaps introduce simplicity of choice of using the scope. In my opinion, there are three voltage ranges only we need to worry about. 0 to 5 volts for sensors, 0 to 20 volts for anything that's related to consumers that use battery power and current, and 0 to 100. Now, the rainbow scope can go to 200 volts, of course, so things like piezo injectors, etc. So you could increase that with the rainbow scope to 200 volts. That's where induction process takes place, where you get a voltage above the 100 volt threshold. But they're the three ranges that we need to consider. Time bases. Actually, also fairly quite straightforward. Now, choose also three time bases. 1 millisecond for intermittent or switched events, such as injectors, ignition, and other events that happen at a regular high frequency. 0 to, say, 100 milliseconds, a tenth of a second, for events such as repetitive events, things like duty cycle, things like that on actuators. And 0 to 50 seconds. Now that sounds an awfully long time electronically, and indeed it is. But for profile, events over time, such as lambda, such as air mass meter, such as common rail pressure sensor testing, and such as cranking test, which is where we are now. Providing your sample rate is high enough, then the number of events that have been taken as a reference point to represent the waveform as displayed on the screen will then give you the accuracy that you need if you want to zoom in and examine that image in great detail. So, untriggered, free run, which will then report any events which take place with a high sample rate, gives us the accuracy that we require for these kind of tests. So, let me just briefly explain the connectivity, which has already taken place. Voltage is electrical pressure, so we have channel A connected to the positive and negative terminals of the battery. The current clamp is around the circuit which goes to the consumer, the starter motor. And I'd just like to point something out. I've selected a 1 volt range for this tool, not a current range. Speed is the decision here. The sensitivity or attenuation of this clamp is 1 millivolt per amp. Now, if I set 1 volt as a range on channel 2, red, which I have, 1,000 millivolts in 1 volt, 1,000 amps range. It's that quick, that simple. Remember, accuracy, speed, efficiency. I also, and this can be controversial, like to see current going down for this test because I'm taking it out of the battery. I'm not measuring the consumption as a positive from the starter, but as a negative out of the battery. So I want to see both voltage go down and current go down. So I can actually also visually compare them much more easily, and I think you'll appreciate that when we run the test. So we're set up, we're ready to go. I've disconnected the camshaft sensor, which in our case should prevent the injectors from being phased or triggered, so the vehicle won't start. I want to run this over an extended period. And the scope is running, and let's just reset the time base so the sweep begins from now. Let's conduct the test and view the results. This is a timed out test. It will prevent cranking after a limited period. Okay, so around about 10 seconds or so, a little bit longer of test duration. And initially, what I want to look at is voltage drop. Now, you might be surprised at sometimes how much that voltage drop represents. Now, the tool I'm going to use here, we've got a fairly high sample rate, 4 mega samples over the sweep time. I want to focus on, we have obviously static battery voltage, but I want to look at the voltage under load. You never test a circuit unless it's on load. So I'm going to use that particular tool to allow me to expand into that part of the image. And you can see we still have a very high quality image because of the reasonably high sample rate. And I want to look at maximum voltage drop. And we can see from the scaling, in fact, if I just get my arrow back, channel A, 7.67. Sounds quite dramatic, but that's a static engine. Let's have a look at the average. Now, if you use a specialised tool, perhaps other than the scope, you look at averages, and averages always worry me because you're never quite sure what absolute values are. But the average voltage drop during cranking, and these images represent compression. If we take an average through there, we have 10.32, which is a respectable figure. We're looking for around 10.5. So, how can we judge the voltage drop? Well, actually we can't, because it depends on what the consumer's drawing, before we can assume that the battery's in good condition or not. So, let's take a look at the consumer, the actual starter motor, current. Now, once again, let's use that tool and expand into this part of the image. And you can see quite a dramatic consumption of current here. Once again, let's measure the current. Peak current appears there. Channel B, minus 917. That's a little bit generous. Let's go up a touch, about there. 905 millivolts, 905 amps. Note how quick that decision can be made. And because I've left that as scaling as voltage, it means that when I finish that current measurement, I go straight back with my voltage probe and I can carry on doing voltage checks. For me, it's about speed. Okay, so that's an enormous amount of current. Does that mean that the consumer, the starter motor, is faulty? Not necessarily, no. Is the engine cold? I'll fix the oil. How much physical work has it got to do in turning the engine over? These are all decisions that affect the performance of the consumer. What's the average current consumption once the engine starts to turn? So let's take the cursor once again, take an average right through the compression events, which are distributed or displayed there, and we have minus 268 millivolts, 268 amps. Is that reasonable? Well, that depends on the size of the battery. The consumer should take about 3.5 times the ampere hour rating of the battery. So we're looking for, let's call it 250. Let's hopefully keep the mathematics simple. This battery has an ampere hour rating of 74. Let's call it 70. 714, 21, 210 amps plus a little bit more. We have 268. You know what? We're pretty much on the money. So the size of the battery should determine the average consumption of the consumer. Both of those are within specification. So despite we have what appears to be a fairly high voltage drop and a certainly fairly high initial current draw, I have no worries about the amount of energy, current taken from the battery by the consumer, the starter motor. Now the vital part. All of this, of course, will affect rotation speed. Now we also have formulas for rotation speed. This is a fairly old vehicle. It needs to rotate a minimum of 200 RPM. 250 would be good. Now, tempered with that, of course, we now have modern stop-start systems. And on those systems, perhaps with more advanced battery design, then we should be looking around 300 RPM. So I'm expecting somewhere between 200 and 250 RPM. To measure rotation speed and calculate it, that in itself is quite straightforward. If we use the horizontal cursors found here in the left-hand bottom column, vertical cursors, I should say, and we take two events, it's a four-stroke engine, so two compression events, any two compression events is sufficient, and of course, the more accurate you make these events, and they're reasonably accurate. And the calculation of rotation speed, 245.78 RPM, absolutely on the money. So what have we proved here? We've proved in several ways. Voltage drop, current draw, and rotation speed based against the ampere hour rating of the battery all form that magic triangular performance which proves the circuit and the consumer are correct to specification.